Welcome to the program. I'm your host, Neal Howard. Thank you so much for joining us here today on Health Professional Radio. Our guest in studio is Mr. Jeff Miller, Vice President and General Manager of the Givosiran Program at Alnylam. He's here today to discuss the company's recent announcement concerning a treatment of acute hepatic porphyrias. Thank you so much for joining us here on the program, Mr. Jeff Miller.
Thank you, Neal. Appreciate you having me on today.
I'm glad that you could take the time and educate our audience a bit about AHPs.
So, Neal, the acute hepatic porphyrias are primarily caused by a genetic mutation in one of the 8 enzymes responsible for heme biosynthesis in the liver. And this includes a few different forms. The first is AIP, which is acute intermittent porphyria. This is the most prevalent form. Also, hereditary coproporphyria, also known as HCP, variegate porphyria, which is VP, and ALAD deficiency porphyria, also known as ADP. And in this AHP disease, what happens is the accumulation of ALAS1, which is an enzyme in the heme biosynthesis pathway, can lead to the accumulation of 2 neurotoxic heme intermediates. One is called 5-aminolevulinic acid, also known as ALA, and porphobilinogen, also known as PBG. And what we found is that inhibition of ALAS1 is known to reduce the accumulation of ALA and PBG, which are in fact the reasons for the clinical manifestations in AIP as well as the AHP.
Now, you've recently initiated this ENVISION Phase 3 trial of Givosiran?
Yes, Neal. So Givosiran, it's a very exciting time for the porphyria community. This would appear, if you look at our Phase 1 results, to be a true innovation and a great opportunity to help many, many patients. So what we are doing is we've launched this Phase 3 study called ENVISION. This is going to be in over 20 countries, and as of now, the target number of patients in the study will be around 75. This is going to be a study that looks at primarily the reduction of these attacks, which manifest with severe pain, neurovisceral symptoms. The vast majority of attacks require patients to go into the hospital, require emergency room or urgent care visits. Mm-hmm. And what we're evaluating as the primary endpoint in the ENVISION study is the reduction of these attacks in patients in all of the acute hepatic porphyrias.
So you're developing something that's going to attack all of them in the same way, even though there are so many different types?
The way the drug works is by targeting ALAS1. And by reducing ALAS1, the hypothesis is that it will then take down ALA and PBG, which in fact has been proven in the phase one. There's a very clear correlation. And by doing that, what we've seen in AIP, which is when you look at the phase one, the only subtype that was enrolled was AIP. However, the mechanism of the disease of the AHPs suggests that by taking ALAS1 down and corresponding levels of ALA and PBG, that there's a belief that all of these subtypes can be treated. And that's what we intend to evaluate.
Well, how many people would you say are dealing with this condition, and who exactly is it affecting?
Well, the disease can affect both men and women. Mm-hmm. However, it predominantly affects women, typically starting in the teens. And if you were to look at the range of ages where the disease first presents, that's going to be starting in the teens, 20s, 30s, and 40s. So this is, as you can imagine, very, very challenging, because if you listen to some of the stories that have been told by patients with this disease, families of patients with this disease, it's very, very difficult. It's devastating. I would encourage anyone listening to go out and look for the voice of the patient. There was a meeting back in March that the American Porphyria Foundation put together with the FDA, held down in Washington, where patients came and shared about their journey with porphyria, which in some cases can take up to 15 years. to finally get a diagnosis, because this is such a difficult disease to tease out. And some of these stories are incredibly, incredibly heartbreaking. But I think this is the best lens into how this disease affects people and the people around them.
How quickly do you think Givosiran will be on the market?
At this point in time, Neal, we have, I would summarize it as exceptionally good news across the board. So let me start here in the U.S. We have first been given breakthrough designation by the FDA, which puts Givosiran in a position to have a higher level of interaction with the FDA and puts the drug in a position to hopefully come to market faster. What we also have landed on is an alignment with the FDA on what's called an interim analysis, or IA, where we will measure the reductions in ALA, which I mentioned before, in 30 patients after 3 months of therapy. And if the data are positive, we intend to submit to the FDA at or around year-end 2018, which could put us in a position to have the drug approved sometime, let's say, middle of 2019, which again, is an incredibly fast timeline when you think that the first data readout that we had from Givosiran was about a year ago at ASH. So that's the U.S. And in Europe, essentially, the same story holds. We were awarded PRIME designation earlier in the year, which has many of the same features of breakthrough. And what we're working on right now is finishing up an alignment with the European regulatory authorities on what the filing package might look like there. And there's going to be more information to come on that side. But so far, the receptiveness of both agencies in Europe and the U.S. has been incredibly positive. They see the devastation from porphyria. They see the benefits that Givosiran can provide and are extremely interested in working closely with us.
Have you noticed any differences in results based on age? And are there any preventive measures?
We have not seen anything in terms of differences in age. And in terms of prevention, this is a disease that stems from, as I mentioned before, elevated levels of ALAS1 and then PBG and ALA. Now, some patients, once they get to know their disease, suggest there may be triggers that they can try and avoid. However, this is difficult to manage, as you can imagine. And having a drug like Givosiran, which is able to knock down this ALAS1 enzyme to the degree that normalizes it, would at least put patients in a position where the biology will be more like a normal healthy individual, and that puts them in a position to hopefully lead a healthier life. But in terms of differences, in terms of age and gender, we've seen consistency across the board.
In terms of this being a rare disease among rare diseases, how do you see the future of any development based on the fact that it is an ultra rare disease? Awareness of some rare diseases is less than others based on how many people are suffering or projected to be dealing with the condition. Sometimes funding issues may interfere with releases or things of that nature. Just wondering how that might affect.
What we are seeing right now is there's an incredibly low awareness of porphyria. As with many rare diseases, the diagnosis rates are very low because the awareness is so low. What we've found in talking to physicians over the past year, I would say, is probably the time window that's most germane. Once they recognize what the patients look like, and what you have to remember, Neal, is these symptoms are very common. Midsection pain, that is when patients are not in attack, can be viewed as something as benign as an appendix. I mean, again, this is appendicitis. This is not intended to suggest any of these are unimportant, but rather it's hard to distinguish because the awareness is so low. what we've seen is that when presented with patient cases, physicians do remember porphyria from medical school, but there's a long way to go. And what we're looking forward to doing is partnering with the APC, the American Porphyria Consortium, the APF, the American Porphyria Foundation, and the medical community to help create awareness and elevate the diagnosis rates of this disease, because right now there are a lot of patients out there who are suffering, and it's because the awareness is so low and there are no viable long-term treatments that it's difficult to find the right diagnosis and treatments. We believe that with the introduction of givosiran, it will put patients in a much better position to be treated with a drug that is intended to be used for chronic therapy.
Thank you, Jeff. Jeff, for coming in, giving us this information. I'm hoping that you'll come back and give us some updates as things do develop around this brand new treatment for acute hepatic porphyrias. Thank you for coming in.
Thank you, Neal. I appreciate the opportunity to speak with you.
You've been listening to Health Professional Radio. I'm your host, Neal Howard. Transcripts and audio of this program are available at healthprofessionalradio.com.au and also at hpr.fm. Be sure to subscribe to the podcast on iTunes, listen in, and download at SoundCloud, and visit our affiliates page at hpr.fm.